Okay, so welcome to the second week of our workshop on integrable systems. So this week we'll have a series of research lectures. We'll still have one or two pedagogical lectures. There's one today, one follow-up tomorrow, and then later in the week we have some lectures as well. But we'll have a lot more research-oriented talks. So the first speaker is my colleague from ICTS, Amit Apte. So Amit, I guess a brief introduction, did his PhD at the University of Texas, Austin, and was a postdoc at MSRI for a while before he moved to TFR CAM. And then he's been at ICTS since the inception, mostly. Almost. So today, Amit is going to talk about dynamical systems, data assimilation, and possibly about cuisine from all parts of the world. We'll see. All right. Thank you, Amit.
Yeah. Okay. Thanks, Vishal and Rukmini, for organizing this workshop and also giving me the opportunity to speak here. This is not my second business, in case the academics doesn't work out. I guess we all have seen, the restaurants like this, everything at one place, or lots of things at one place, not everything, but lots of. So my talk was kind of, not necessarily quite closely related topics within data assimilation and dynamical systems, but things which are not necessarily very closely related to each other. So it will be something like this. I'm assuming that apart from Sumit, probably nobody else knows too much about data assimilation. So I will start with the introduction to data assimilation, and then I will move to this Indo-European US cuisine, which is a collaboration across the three different countries, and talking about how dynamical system aspects, in particular unstable subspaces and so on, appear in data assimilation. A large part of work was basically while Karthik was a postdoc here at ICTS, and but jointly with other people that I mentioned here, Mark, Alberto, Chris, and Colin. Colin, who was a student of Chris, now a postdoc in Norway and moving back to US within a few months. Okay, the second part, which is kind of related to this, but still fairly independent, is about stability of Kalman-Bucci filters. So in particular for linear data assimilation problems, can we understand stability? And also, there will be a bit about unstable subspaces here as well. And this is the work of Sumit's thesis, which is ongoing, jointly with Streaker from TFR CAM. And at the end, if I have time, let's see how I go. Then I will talk about model error, which is another completely different topic. And this is just essentially uncooked. It's still not, we don't have any concrete results yet, but maybe hopefully soon enough. And at various times, I had various visits at various places, thanks to Infosys Foundation and Airbus Chair Program for funding Karthik's postdoctoral fellowship. Okay, so unusual way to start a talk, which is what I will not talk about. I thought I'd make connections to at least some of the topics in the workshop here, but since I have not worked on these topics, I'm not going to talk about it. But so Kalman filters, which I will describe in detail later, but just take the word as a name right now, have connections to symplectic geometry through considering basically there is a way to formulate the Kalman filter, in particular the Riccati equation that comes up, which I will mention later, in terms of a Hamiltonian system, and hence in terms of dynamics of symplectic or dynamics on symplectic, in particular Lagrangian subspaces of a symplectic space. And so this was has been sort of explored over the years, over the last maybe 15-20 years, through the work of mainly Maciek and Bujarol, and these are a series of papers which are very interesting connections to geometry of these filtering problems. But I have not really worked on it much. Sumit did a project for about a couple of months, a few months ago, but we haven't explored it in more detail. So I will not really talk too much about it, but maybe we can discuss it later if you're interested. A similar connection, not exactly the same, but to Hamiltonian systems comes through writing the Kanban-Bucci equations, the Ricard equation in particular, as a Ricard equation for a linear Hamiltonian system, and looking at the stability properties of the Hamiltonian system in order to infer something about the stability of the filtering problem. And there, the main concept that comes up is exponential dichotomy and so on. I guess we are exploring a little bit use of exponential dichotomy, since it's still completely in progress and not very clear as exactly how it's going to go, I'm not going to talk about it, but at least one way of relating Hamiltonian systems and exponential dichotomy to filters is already in this paper. Okay, so the rest of the talk will be purely about data assimilation. This is also data assimilation, very different viewpoint. So what is data assimilation in the first place? Right. So I think of it as there are multiple definitions in literature. This is my definition. It's a black art of using observational data, which is of course noisy. That's really unnecessary to put as an adjective, but partial. And use these observations of a system which is typically chaotic and complex. Think about the atmosphere, the ocean, and so on. And of such a complex system, which is also chaotic. What we have available is an imperfect model of the data noise as well as the system dynamics. So the model that we have is not perfect. There are missing bits and pieces in the model. And we want to combine the observations with the model in order to get predictions and uncertainty for this prediction. Right? So that's one possible definition of data assimilation problem. So the schematic picture here is think of a chaotic dynamical system trajectory shown in red here. So think of the atmosphere, which is going along forward in time. What we have is not the actual trajectory, but the observations. Right now I'm showing it as discrete time observations. So these blue dots are some observations with some observational noise or errors in this system. And then if we want to make predictions, and if you start with some ensemble of initial conditions of this, because of the chaotic nature, in addition to other things, we will deviate from what the true system does. We want to make corrections to this in order to come closer to what the true system really is. Again, if you go forward in time, there will be deviations from the true system, and this process will continue. And we have to continuously use observations in order to bring our predictions closer to what the actual system is doing. And that's a picture that I have in mind for a data assimilation problem. Right? Okay, so it's a state estimation problem. We want to estimate the state of the system. So typical applications are, I mean, the historically, the word data assimilation, as opposed to filtering theory or other state estimation problems, came from weather prediction. So the name is probably about 40, 50 years old, roughly, data assimilation as a phrase. And this is essentially the largest application of data assimilation and the most, so to say, motivating source of problems for data assimilation. Of course, climate prediction is theoretically similar, but not quite exactly, because there are lots of uncertainties in climate prediction, as in weather prediction as well. But it's not clear whether the initial condition is the most determining source of uncertainty in climate prediction or not. There is lots of other sources of errors. So, so. But there are also applications in other areas which are slowly being considered, ecology, biology, and so on and so forth. But typically, having very good dynamical models is kind of essential for data assimilation, and that's a problem for these kind of applications where the models may not be accurate enough, and they are a major source of uncertainty. So, okay, so a few characteristic in words. I will convert all of these into equations in the next slide, I think. But typically, data assimilation problems like these, there are good physical theories, but that does not translate into having good models. Important point, I think, that is usually neglected. But anyway, for example, if you have a good, if you believe that the atmosphere is a fluid dynamical system, that does not mean that you understand the dynamics of clouds well, for example. Even though everything is fluids, right? Okay, so that's one example of this, right? The systems are nonlinear, chaotic. Again, if I say chaotic, then nonlinear is unnecessary, but anyway, usually deterministic. So these are not, so sometimes people have started looking at stochastic models of the climate and weather and so on, but still, most of the models are deterministic. These systems have multiple scales in time and in space, and they are very high dimensional. If you believe that fluid dynamics is a good description, then really it's an infinite dimensional dynamical system, but typically with a very high dimensional load attractor, which is not infinite dimensional, embedded within this. But high dimensions typically can go from anywhere to several thousands to millions. There isn't a good estimate of the dimension of the attractor for the atmosphere, but it's very high dimensional for sure. The observation that we have are noisy. Of course, that's again unnecessary, but still, just to emphasize. The main problem with the noisy observations is that the noise characteristics are poorly understood. Typically, Gaussian noise is used, but it's not clear why Gaussian is used. It's just used because it's easy. That's pretty much the only, or you can throw around words like central limit theorem, but anyway. And these are partial observations, so we can't observe everything in the system, that's obvious. And they are very sparse. So typical models that are used for, say, weather prediction have something like 10 to 8 variables these days. Global models, local models may be smaller, but global models have something like 10 million or 20 million, 100 million variables. And the number of observations that are available at any given time are of the order of maybe 100,000 or much less typically. So it's there is at least several orders of magnitude difference between the number of state variables you want to estimate and the number of observations you have available at any given time. They're discrete in time. For example, the time scale of the atmosphere could be several minutes to hours and so on. The observations available maybe once every day, once every few hours and so on. So they're definitely discrete in time, as opposed to engineering systems where continuous time observations is a good approximation. If you have a chemical plant, the observations are fairly frequent, several hertz, several thousands of hertz and so on possibly. That's not the case for these problems here. So the main mathematical tool is what I will talk about, essentially filtering theory, but really with lots of bells and whistles which are specific to these kind of high-dimensional multi-scale problems, high-dimensional multi-scale chaotic problems with sparse observations. So that's why you need these bells and whistles, which takes up all my time, the bells and whistles. Okay, so just to the broad framework of filtering theory is as follows. So consider a Markov chain, a dynamical system, a stochastic dynamical system. I will eventually go from a stochastic system to a deterministic system by adding by neglecting the noise in the system, which is data here. And for such a system, we will assume that the initial condition is unknown, and hence we'll assume some prior probability density for the initial condition, PA. The reason for A will become clear. And the problem we want to think about is estimating the state, XT, at some time, T, given observations from, say, time 1 to time N, or T1 to TN. And typically, so the observations are always assumed to be local in time, in the sense that the observation at time T is a function of the state at time T with additive noise. Additive noise is a convenient approximation if you make it into a multiplicative noise. For example, if you multiply this by a state-dependent covariance, then the theory becomes much harder. And usually in data assimilation, that's not what is done. I will come to this point hopefully towards the end of the talk if I have time. But for now, we'll stick with additive noise and the state, the observation dependent on time itself. So this is called observation operator, and eta is the observational noise. So the main object of interest will be a posterior distribution, essentially the distribution of the state conditioned on the observations that are given to us. So if the observations are given between, say, time 1 to time n, or time 0 to time n, and you are trying to estimate the state at time t, which is between 0 and n, then that is called a smoothing problem, just a terminology, but very useful and commonly used one. And if you are trying to estimate the state at the time of the final observation, that's called a filtering problem. And estimating the state at any time beyond that is a prediction problem. So I will focus on the filtering problem. So the filtering problem has a, sort of say, theoretical answer, which can be written down easily in some sense in the discrete time case. And it goes as follows. So it's useful to think of it in terms of a two-step approach. So just a notation, I will concatenate all the times from 1 to n to indicate 1 is 1 to t and 1 to t. And so if I'm interested in the state at time t plus 1, given observations up to time t, then that can be obtained by using the Markov property which I mentioned earlier. So if you have the distribution of the state up to time t, at time t, given observations up to time t, then you multiply it by the Markov transition kernel for the Markov chain which I wrote down earlier, and that gives you this conditional distribution. That's just essentially a definition of conditional distribution. And then you apply Bayes' theorem in order to incorporate observations at time t plus 1. So now, if your observations at time t plus 1 and all the observations up to time t, and if you want to condition on this whole object, then the Bayes' theorem helps us to go from this density to that. By the Bayes' theorem simply says that you multiply this density by the density for the observations at time t plus 1, given the state at time t plus 1. And so by using the Markov property of the dynamical system and the Bayes' theorem, you effectively obtain a recursive relation to go from time t to time t plus 1 by simply multiplying by the Markov transition kernel and the observational likelihood. So the result is actually straightforward and easy. If you want a filtering density out of this, so you notice that this is a density for the state from time 1 to time t plus 1, but you can take the marginal at time t plus 1, and that gives the filtering density. So, yes. So let me maybe just write it down here. So the object of interest is basically the conditional, what is called a posterior, which is the conditional distribution I will write everything in terms of densities rather than measures or distributions, but distribution of a state xt conditioned on the observations. And these are, as I said, it will be time 1, time 2, up to some time tn. Oh, let me just write it as n, make it easier. And so we are interested in pxt given y1, y2, up to yn. And if t is equal to n, that is the state at time n, given observations up to that time, then that is called a filtering problem. Filtering problem. And if t is less than n, then that is called smoothing. And t greater than n, of course, that's a prediction. So the reason for filtering is that in some sense it's trying to filter out the noise in the observations, and that's yeah. Oh, yeah, so I guess, I mean, this is basically density at time t plus 1, given observations up to time t. And so that's like a forecast. So maybe I can draw an arrow here. So this is, right, if this is time, and I have observations up to time t, but I'm looking for density at time t plus 1. So I have only past observations. And hence, this is like a forecast, right? Forecast from time t up to time t plus 1. When we incorporate observation at time t plus 1, which is the next line here, then that is called update or analysis. So F stands for forecast, and A stands for analysis. Analysis is a, very weird word, but that's the word that comes from the data assimilation literature from earth sciences. So that's why PA, or sometimes it's called PU, because it's updated using observations at T. It's just a notation, essentially. Useful notation. Yeah. Okay. So in discrete time, the theoretical answer is you can write down in one line, but then that doesn't really help you really understand the answer well. In continuous time setup, the similar answer will be basically the Zakayer-Kushner-Stratonovich equation, which I will write down also a bit later. Okay, so that theoretical answer is not very useful. For example, you can't really solve that recursive relation as such. You can't explicitly write down the density. There is a formula for it, but you have to calculate it numerically, except in a few cases, which is one of them is the linear case. So if everything inside is linear and Gaussian, so the model is linear, the Markov transition model, the observation operator is linear, the noise in these models, the observational noise and the model noise, both are Gaussian. The zero is not necessary for the mean, but it's easy to take care of that. And if the initial condition itself is also Gaussian, then all the distributions appearing in this recursive relation are really Gaussian. And that's easy to prove, and also straightforward to see. You're just multiplying by things which are always Gaussian, and product of two Gaussian densities is Gaussian, and so on. So hence we can describe all of these in purely in terms of the covariances and the means. So again, just notation, this PA, which was the analysis, which I mentioned here, it's indicated by the mean and the covariance, or it's fully described by the mean and the covariance. The forecast as well, so the density at time t plus 1 given observations up to time t is also described by a mean and a covariance, and the Markov transition kernel also has a mean and covariance that's given here. Okay, so all we need to deal with are these finite dimensional objects the mean and the covariance rather than the densities or the distributions. Right? Okay, so, and again, there is a two-step process, the update and the prediction step. So the prediction step is it's simply using the model, the linear model, for the mean as well as for the covariance. And that just follows from the properties of Gaussian distributions. And update step, which also follows from distribution properties of conditional Gaussian distributions, is that you can update the mean and the covariance as well. So you go from xa at time t to xa at time t plus, sorry, xf at time t to xf at time t plus 1 and repeat this process. So it's a recursive relation again. And again, in parallel with the previous remark, in continuous time, both of these get replaced by this two-step process, so to say, gets replaced by a quadratic Ricard equation for the covariance and a linear stochastic differential equation for the mean. And that's the, so theoretically, this is also quite convenient to study. Okay, so that's the Kalman filter, which I promised to describe at the beginning of the talk. So you can see that, you know, this can be described in terms of the geometry of these covariances in terms of a Hamiltonian system, but I will not talk about that here. Okay, there's a very commonly used technique which is called ensemble Kalman filter. So if the state space X here is, for example, in the weather prediction problem, is a million or 10 million dimensional object, then the covariance, which was on the previous slide somewhere, is a 10 million by 10 million matrix. So doing anything numerically at all, let alone even probably usually storing that matrix itself, is essentially impossible. If you want to do any kind of operations on a 10 million cross 10 million matrix, find eigenvalues or whatever, and so on, or just push forward in time, it's a essentially hopeless task. And so, apart from the fact that it's a nonlinear model, that's another thing, but even if you want to deal with a 10 million dimensional linear system, it's not really possible to use these equations because these are 10 million cross 10 million matrices, and hence you can't really do anything. Right? Okay. So, one way to get around this problem is to use a description of this probability distribution in terms of samples. So the idea is that if you have n, okay, sorry, not this n, the time, but if you have n samples from the state space, xti, the I is now representing the samples, then essentially the idea is, the main idea behind sampling is that you approximate the density by a sum of simply delta distributions. Right? Or there are other ways to describe this mathematically as well, but for us, this will be sufficient. So the ensemble Kalman filter uses a representation in terms of samples rather than the mean and the covariance of the Gaussian distribution. Right? And it's approximation, but the way it works is, now using these samples, you can simply replace the prediction step to be applying this model that we have to each of the samples. So you go from, say, time t minus 1 to t by using, and in the case of ensemble Kalman filter, it's used even for nonlinear models. So as an algorithm, this is well-defined. Whether it actually converges to something useful or not, that's a separate topic, and I will not really spend much time on that. But as an algorithm, you simply take the samples, apply a nonlinear model to it, you get samples at time t. That's the prediction step, which is fully nonlinear. And then the update step uses the Kalman filter, which is only exact for a linear dynamical system. Right? So it's a mixture of weird approximations, but it just works magically. And part of it works is theoretically justified, part of it works is not, and we can discuss it later if you are interested in what exactly this algorithm really does. But I thought I'll mention it because it's a it's a very commonly used algorithm nowadays. And this is, so to say, essentially in most weather prediction centers, something like this, a variant of it with lots of bells and whistles, which I'm not mentioning here, is what is really used for weather prediction in many operational centers as well these days. So it's magical that it works for a highly non-linear complex system also, even though it's based on a theory which comes from purely linear dynamical system. Okay, so so that's the so the current state of what where the theoretical research is like I tried to capture it in this. So for example, the filtering theory for stochastic processes in continuous time observations has been a fairly well-developed theory, starting with the work of Kushner, Stratonovich, Zakai, and so on. They have an equation named after each of them. And as well as filtering theory for linear systems is very well developed. Typically, the places where these things are used are low dimensional, and most of these systems are non-chaotic. For example, chemical plants, electrical circuits, and so on and so forth, or the space applications, motion of satellites around the Earth or even outside in the space. So this theoretical framework, with discrete time observations for chaotic systems, is not yet very well developed. So exactly what happens, what changes in terms of stability properties and well posedness and so on for chaotic dynamical systems is not very well understood yet. For example, there are approaches, numerical approaches like particle filtering or PDE approaches for solving the Fokker-Planck equation and so on. They don't really work well for chaotic systems. So that's not well developed yet. So even though this kind of specific theoretical framework is available in applications, the filtering theory is only used for low dimensional systems, typically 10, 15, 20, something like that, not a million dimensions. For high dimensional problems, there are some numerically promising approaches which are developed over the last maybe 10, 15 years or so, particle filtering being one of them, ensemble Kalman filter being another. But really very high dimensional complex and chaotic systems, it just if last few years since. Well, okay, so 2-3 years is probably not a good estimate. Maybe 5 years. Okay, so that's partly what I will be describing. Some results in trying to understand the relation between instabilities in dynamics and the filtering theory problems. Okay, so that brings me to the next point, which is how do you understand what unstable subspaces do? So remember this linear model, right? The Kalman filter only works in linear systems. And that goes as follows. You have at time zero, you have the forecast, then you get the update, and so on and so forth. So there is this forecast and update step. And the sequence, we would like to understand what happens to this sequence asymptotically in time. Right? So in particular, the covariances, whether they converge or not, and if they converge, what's the relation to the dynamics is what we try to study. Okay, so there is an explicit solution to this problem in some sense. That is, you can explicitly write down the coherence at time t as a function of the coherence at time zero in terms of the model and observation operators, which are all linear objects now. So these are all really just matrices. An alternative form is here. These two are related through a fairly straightforward calculation. And this is the explicit formula is quite useful to understand what happens to these objects in time. Okay, so in particular, this is just repeating what I wrote down in the previous slide. It's a straightforward proof. For example, by induction, this is really easy to do, proving this relation. In the absence of observation, that is, if you simply are looking at the forecast covariance, which is not conditional covariance, that is, without taking into account observation, then it can also be written down in a fairly straightforward way. in terms of the model and the initial covariance. Right? So I thought it might be useful to just write down a one-dimensional example in this case. So if X is one-dimensional and M is one, so everything here is not a matrix, now just a number, all objects here are one-dimensional, then you can see that this is this relation can be explicitly solved. So I'm not going to, let me not write down. Yeah, it's a one-line calculation to do one dimensions. The theta t, which is object over here, turns out to be simply a geometric series, and you can sum it up. It turns out to be, remember the model I said is one-dimensional. So mt is simply a constant m. So one-dimensional autonomous, that is time-independent dynamical system. So mt is this, and ht is just equal to 1, and rt is simply r, right? Time-independent. So theta t happens to be a geometric series, and it turns out to be m to the power 2t minus 1 over m square minus 1 times 1 over r. And sigma t, the covariance at time t, it is of the form m square minus 1 so that's a straightforward calculation as well. And unconditional covariance, the covariance of the system without taking into account observation, in the absence of observations, happens to be, what is it? M to the power 2t sigma naught. Oh, I forgot to mention the important point here. This is for qt equal to 0. So in this case, again, no observational noise. Right. And so, M is the dynamics. So the dynamical system basically is xt plus 1 is equal to mxt, which means that it's unstable for m greater than 1. It diverges, and that's unstable dynamics. And what happens in the case when m is greater than 1 is, so this term will dominate in the denominator, and that will dominate in the numerator, and those will cancel each other, and it turns out that sigma t will simply go to, m square minus 1 times r, whereas sigma hat t diverges. And for stable dynamics, when m is, so stable dynamics corresponds to m less than 1, so the system just goes to 0. In this case, both sigma hat t goes to 0 and sigma t also goes to 0. So for stable dynamics, the covariance goes to 0. That means you essentially become, the distribution becomes degenerate, the Gaussian distribution with zero covariance. And for unstable dynamics, even though the unconditional covariance diverges, the conditional covariance goes to some constant value, which is independent of sigma naught, the initial condition. And so that's sort of the most basic statement of stability. That is, independent of what you start with, you still get sigma t, which is the same. And non-divergence or convergence to become constant. Okay, so that's what we proved in the general case where even if, I mean, this is a simple one-dimensional calculation, but in general, if QT is equal to zero, deterministic dynamics, then the rank of sigma t is determined by the stabilities or the instabilities of the system in particular, right? So it is equal to, actually, sorry, this should be, the rank should be less equal. It of course can't be greater than the rank of the initial condition at time t equal to zero, but it's also determined by the number of unstable neutral dimensions. So in all the stable direction, the coherence goes to zero, but in the unstable direction, the coherence can remain non-zero. And that's why the rank has a relation to the number of unstable directions in the dynamics, or in particular, number of non-negative Lyapunov exponents, basically. In the general time-dependent case, it is the Lyapunov exponent that matters. Okay. And the relation to Lyapunov exponents is quite explicit. If lambdas are the Lyapunov exponents, if lambda k is a Lyapunov exponent, which is basically the as t goes to infinity, the left singular value of m, or log of the left singular value of m t zero, then the eigenvalues of this covariance matrices are upper bounded by these objects, and hence if lambda is negative, then asymptotically these will be negative, and these eigenvalues will go to zero, and that's what essentially you see here. Also, if you take the left singular vectors of the dynamics, then the projection of the covariance onto the left singular vector goes to zero as well. So we can identify the subspaces on which the coherence goes to zero. So the coherence is low rank, and the directions in which it's low rank can be identified by using the left singular vectors, which are also related to the Lyapunov vectors in some cases of the dynamics. So that gives the explicit relation between the Lyapunov exponents and the Lyapunov spaces with the filtering problem here, which was one of the aims, right? Okay, so let me skip the numerical. I mean, so you can see this to numerics. One of the main motivations for this was a observation in earth sciences, which was for about last 15 years or so, 20 years maybe, people have been trying to understand this. And so this is a series of papers by Anna Trevisan and co-authors. This is one of the reviews of that literature. They are basically plotting the rank of the covariance as a function of time in some large scale. I think this was in a dynamical system with 80 dimensions or something like that. I don't remember exactly, but maybe more than 80. And they saw numerically that the rank decreases in time, but eventually it becomes, so to say, constant, stable. And they wanted to understand what happens. Why is this the case? And in particular, the rank seems to be somewhere near the dimension of the unstable and neutral space. And this was a purely numerical observation earlier, and now we have theoretical results to justify why actually that happens. So this was a motivation, these observations in the earth sciences that are in these papers. So this property of rank deficiency is quite a useful thing. For example, the ensemble Kalman filter, which I mentioned, for a million or a 10 million dimensional problem, is used with about 100 samples. So you have 100 member ensemble that is used to sample a million dimensional state space. And it seems to work. Even discounting for the fact that, you know, the attractor is probably smaller dimensional, the 100 is too small a dimensional. It's too small a number of samples to explain any of this. But it turns out that the number of instabilities, and particularly the number of local instabilities, and you can define it in some appropriate way, is around 100 in the atmosphere and ocean. So this idea of localization, which is that you simply look at the covariance is only in a local neighborhood, it's somehow very closely related to why ensemble Kalman filter works well. And that is related to the instabilities of the system. And so this is understood, or this is a puzzle that has essentially no theoretical justification right now. It just seems to work and kind of makes sense for people in doing practicing these, I mean, actually implementing these in practice, but it's not clear what's the mathematical relation between these ideas of local instabilities, the localization of the covariance that is used in ensemble Kalman filter, and why the Kalman filter works with such small number of samples for extremely large system. So the relation between this locality in the dynamics and the local in space covariances and so on is still not well understood. And of course, any of this for nonlinear problems is still not. Hopefully, we're working on it. We think we are working on it. But okay. Let me go through this section. I'll probably skip the model error section. Okay, so this is basically work of Sumit, who is sitting in the back there, and including the slides. So all the mistakes are his, and all the good results are mine, except for the statement that I just made. This is a continuous time framework. So he's basically trying to understand his results in the framework of stochastic filtering theory. In the continuous time. Right, so in the continuous time, it will be now in terms of stochastic differential equation for the state and a stochastic differential equation for the observation. Both x and t are continuous in time. So t, and then there are assumptions about independence of these objects, which are essential to make the theory easier. Without these assumptions, it becomes much more complicated. Can be done, but not easily. Okay, so in this case, what we are interested again is a distribution of the state at time t, conditioned on the observations up to time t, in particular, basically conditioned on sigma algebra of observations up to time t. And the governing equation for this object, or in particular, governing equation basically for expectations with respect to this object, this distribution, is what is known as the Kushner-Stratonovich equation, which is a nonlinear, so it's basically a nonlinear PDE for these functions, right, phi. So, there is a term which depends on the dynamics, the generator for the dynamics, and a term that depends on the observations. And so I'm not really going to spend time on this, so I just put it up as a reference. But again, this equation is theoretically there, but then it can't really be solved in most cases. It can, for example, be described using finitely many moments, only in a very few set of cases. So Benne filter is one of them, and a linear filter, of course, the Kalman filter, which in this case is called Kalman-Bucci filter, is another such case. And so one of the questions we focused on is to say, if we start with two different initial conditions for this Kushner-Stratonovich equation and look at the solutions, then do they converge in time? So essentially a stability problem, right? Are the solutions asymptotically in time independent of the initial condition? Or can we prove that these the difference between a solution with one initial condition and a solution with another initial condition, do they converge to zero in some appropriate sense? And so the general question has been studied, but we focused on the linear filter. So again, everything inside is linear and Gaussian. And in this case, we can describe again the filter in terms of the mean and the covariance, now continuous in time. And hence, as I said, the mean and the covariance satisfy a stochastic differential equation, which is written over here, and a nonlinear, in fact, quadratic ODE for the covariance. And the equation for the covariance is independent of the mean, but the equation for the mean, of course, depends on the covariance. And that's a property of this linear filter, the Kalman-Bucci filter. Right? So we can simply look at this equation all on its own. And this is the quadratic Riccati equation, dynamical Riccati equation, not algebraic Riccati. setting it equal to zero is the algebraic Ricard equation, or one form of algebraic Ricard equation. Okay, so there have been results in the past. For example, if you take non-autonomous systems, then there's a old result by Okon and Pardew about when these systems are what is known as detectable and stabilizable. I will not explain in detail what that condition is. Then the filter is actually stable. And in particular, it's also stable with respect to non-Gaussian initial condition. So even when X naught is non-Gaussian, you can still prove that the filter is stable. And in fact, the solution is given asymptotically by this linear Kalman-Bucci filter. So it's more general than just linear, actually. Okay, in the non-autonomous case, at least the first result, I don't know about the second result, it's still holds, but by replacing the condition of detectability and stabilizability by a more general condition of what is called uniform complete observability and controllability. But I will not talk much about that yet. Okay, I will talk about observability in a minute, or maybe 2 minutes. Okay, so what we focused on was, but remember, both of these are results when FT, the noise in the dynamics, is not zero, and in particular it is used to FT is what is exactly used to define controllability of the dynamics. If FT is equal to zero, then the system is not controllable or stabilizable in particular. So what we wanted to focus on was this linear deterministic dynamics, in which case, when FT is equal to zero, the system has no detectability or controllability property, and hence the previous results are not valid. The filtering equation is reduced to this. Essentially, you set FT equal to zero, and it just works. So that's good. So the assumption that we make to get a similar result of stability are that these are continuous and uniformly bounded, and we still have to assume the uniform complete observability of the system, but we drop the assumption of controllability, right? And this is in particular in terms of a Gramian, which is written over here. This comes up in the solution of the Ricard equation naturally, and that's why it is useful to have a bound on this Gramian, which is the condition of uniform complete observability. Okay, so under these assumptions, essentially we can prove the stability result. So if we look at the Ricard equation, let me just describe a little bit of the properties of this Ricard equation. If AT, which is the dynamics that we are considering, sorry, it was MT in my earlier slides. In continuous time, now we are calling it AT. So the fundamental matrix or normal, yeah. If you look at the fundamental matrix solution of this linear system and call it phi, then the explicit solution of the Ricard equation can be written here, where BT is exactly the Gramian that occurs in the definition of observability condition. Okay, so this is actually quite useful. From this, we can see that it's uniformly bounded in time, and actually upper bound, not lower bound, and in particular, if you look at the space of spanned by vectors such that the transpose of the fundamental matrix solution on that space goes to zero, the covariance matrix on that space goes to zero. This is analogous to this result in that I was just showing. So in some sense, there is a subspace not quite identified with a unstable subspace yet, but a subspace defined by this object such that the covariance matrix in that direction goes to zero, and in particular, asymptotically in time, so this is as t goes to infinity, sorry, and so asymptotically in time, the covariance matrix is low rank, is a degenerate matrix. Okay, and typically, so the dimension of S is not the full space, of course, but in the case of deterministic systems, autonomous systems, like the ones I was talking about here, these are can be identified with unstable and stable subspaces of the dynamics. So that holds. Okay, let me not go through the example. I don't really have much time. Identifying this space S is still something that we are working on, but the way to look at the stability property is if you have two solutions of the Riccati equation, then you look at the difference. That itself looks like a Riccati equation. It's not quite a Riccati equation, but looks like a Riccati equation with a different dynamical system. And looking at the stability of the Riccati equation, it can be done by looking at asymptotic properties of the fundamental matrix solution of this matrix equation. And that's the method that we use, basically. Okay, so since I don't really have much time, I will not talk about the white elephant in the room, which is the model error. It's one of the topics which is not very heavily, you know, it's something that people are aware of is being a problem, but there isn't a good theoretical framework for it. And that was one of our aims, to try to develop a theoretical framework to discuss model error issues. But we didn't really get, yeah. So these are very preliminary results. As you can see, they're still handwritten. And let me not discuss it. I don't really have much time. And let me just go to the end. So what I mainly focused on was on the stability properties and identifying the stability or discussing the stability in terms of the dynamics of the system. And I didn't discuss model error, but there is lots of things that are still open. For example, nonlinear problems, everything is completely open right now. There isn't any, we don't know exactly what to do. There is a, sort of say, guess that the filtering distribution now will also be singular, and in particular, maybe absolutely, even, for example, this is one way we can think about it. If it's absolutely continuous with respect to SRB measure, which itself is not it's a singular object, then that's a possible characterization, but more precise characterization of the filtering distribution in the case of deterministic nonlinear dynamics is still completely open problem. And okay, I think I'll stop here, thanks.
I have a naive question. So you mentioned that, you know, the most common application for a lot of these filtering theories is in things like weather prediction. So there the model is nonlinear. So do they linearize the dynamics, or do they have some sort of engineering approach where they still apply these ideas to the nonlinear system?
Yeah, so for example, the ensemble Kalman filter, which is provably convergent to the actual true answer in the case of linear dynamics, because it's a Kalman filter variant, is still used in practice with the full nonlinear model. So as I mentioned, the prediction step is done by a nonlinear model, and at the time of updating using the observations, you use the Kalman filter-like equation.
So do you need a certain frequency of observations to make that updates process accurate?
It's an algorithm, so you can just use it.
Do what I want.
That's what people do.
Right. So
any kind of theoretical answer about when it actually converges is not really available. I mean, there are very few. I think one, as far as I know, or two theoretical results about convergence of that for nonlinear models. But there are so many assumptions that those assumptions are not valid. So they make assumptions like complete observations. So you observe everything in the system.
Right.
But then that's not what is done in practice either.
Right.
So essentially, there is no theoretical understanding of.
So as a follow up.
Nonlinear problem at all.
As a follow up for that. So if I just wanted to apply this idea and see how well I was doing for a given nonlinear system.
Okay.
What is the strategy I have to validate? Especially given the fact that for the most common application, the observations are going in to run the system, so it seems a bit.
It's circular, in some sense.
Right. That's a problem, right?
That is a problem.
Okay.
And so a proper definition of what you mean by it works, in practice, is not straightforward at all. What people do is you essentially, for example, leave out a few observations and then test it against them. That's one way to do it, right? So that's one way to test your system. And of course, in actual, so if you want to make a weather prediction, you don't leave out any observations. But to test the systems, you, from using the past observations, you leave out a few of the observations. You do this thing and see how well they compare, how well the predictions that you make compare with the observation that you had left out, so as to make something like independent verification. Yeah, but that's about as good as it gets. Because we don't really know the state of the system apart from the observations themselves. So. None of the theory, like xt minus xt, xt bar going to zero, is useful in practice. We don't have the xt bar. We don't have the actual theoretical answer as well. So,
yeah. If not, oh, yes, 1 second.
Sorry?
What is so special about Monte Carlo filtering?
What is so special about Monte Carlo filtering?
Yes.
It's easy to code up. That's one thing special. But apart from that, I mean, that's one of the approaches that seems to be feasible for very high dimensional systems right now. If you take a million dimensional system, then apart from Monte Carlo, there isn't anything that has worked at all, pretty much. So if you want to apply even Kalman filter, that's not possible, really. As I said, million cross million dimensional matrix going forward in time and so on, that's simply out of question. So Monte Carlo is really essentially the only feasible approach numerically that you have. Thank you.